So welcome to this video, new features in MariaDB 10.7 and 10.8. Now, the first thing you might want to ask is why 10.7 and 10.8? Well, I can refer you to Monty's talk earlier. If you've been watching all the talks here in the dev room, you would have heard Monty's talk explaining the new release model. If you missed that, very, very briefly, MariaDB is no longer doing a single annual release packed full of new features that have had to wait a year. Now they are quarterly releases, which means that the new features get into users' hands more quickly. And another effect is the intention of making things more stable as well. It means that the releases can be, the features can be out there for longer and be tested. And when we do the 0.0 releases, there's also a whole lot of preview releases, which only contains a single new feature. So it's the same as the prior major release, but with the one new feature, which means it's much easier to test, spot any regressions, and realize that they're only due to that one particular issue. So hopefully it will result in features getting out more quickly and greater stability. The result is I'm talking about 10.7 and 10.8 in this talk. So at the time that I'm preparing the talk, 10.7.1 is out as a release candidate, and 10.8.0 is out as a number of preview releases. It's quite possible, quite likely, that by the time this talk is aired, 10.8.1 will be out, so the first full release of 10.8.1, perhaps a release candidate, and 10.7.2 could also be out, and that could quite possibly be a generally available version as well. So do keep an eye out for that. One thing to note is that with the preview releases, the intention is that the features get tested quite heavily as preview releases, which means that not all of the features that appear in a preview will make it to the final release. That's part of the intention. So 10.7, for example, there was JSON histograms, which weren't deemed to be ready yet, so they didn't appear in 10.7.1, and they've made another appearance in the 10.8 preview releases, and hopefully will this time stick around to the final 10.8 release. So onto the new features in 10.7. So the first thing I want to highlight here is that a way for you to participate in the development of MariaDB. Even if you're not a developer, even if you can't submit a pull request or do anything like that, there's still a way to contribute towards progress and the development of MariaDB, and that's by voting on issues, voting and or commenting on the issues in Jira. So the screenshot that I've pulled up here is, at this point in time, a list of all of the issues ordered by votes, so that from most popular down to least popular at the bottom of the page. Obviously it's just the first page, and the reason I bring it up here is that the first feature I want to talk about, UUID, was for a long time at the top of this page. I think it had 36 votes when it was finally pushed into the server, and the point here is that although votes not a magic wand, it doesn't mean that the issue here on top is going to get fixed quickly or going to get fixed at all, but the point is it does get noticed by developers and it does get taken into account when prioritizing tasks and development work. So please do, if you have a pet bug or a pet new feature that you would like to see in MariaDB, please do vote and or comment in Jira. And there's a URL here at the bottom where you can look up, you can access this page with the latest results as well. You can see here that most of these issues have been assigned to somebody, and a few of them are under active development, so in testing, in testing, in review. In fact, some of those are in the preview releases for 10.8, so it does make a difference if something is heavily demanded. It gives us an idea of what the community is requesting and what you would like to see. So UUID, universally unique identifier. The idea is that this, it's a 128-bit value. The idea is that it's unique, or practical purposes, unique in particular time and a particular space. MariaDB has had a UUID function for quite a long time, or perhaps forever, but it hasn't had a native data type. So if you wanted to handle store UUIDs, you might have had to use a binary 16, which then meant you would have had to manually strip the dashes, or perhaps you just used a varchar, and then there are performance implications with that as well. So this has been a really strongly requested feature, and I'm very happy to introduce it. The UUID data type. And it's very simple to use. You simply create the table and define the field as a UUID type. And then you can directly insert into it, either via a string literal, via a hex literal. You can use the UUID function itself to insert the value, or you can use the sysGUID function to create a value as well. SysGUID, I think, if I recall correctly, was introduced in 10.6 for the purposes of Oracle compatibility, and it generates a UUID, but without the dashes being the only difference. So when you return the values, you will always get a standard format with the dashes included. So I hope that's a feature that's going to make people who use UUID's lives a lot easier. Another feature is natural sort. So the idea of natural sort is that it sorts in a more natural, a more human kind of way, where the classic example is A10 is greater than A9. Normally, in a normal sort, A1 would come before the A9, so it'd be sorted the other way around. So here's an example. You can create a table, insert some text values. If you do a normal sort in ascending order, you will get A1, A11, and then A2. If you do the sort using a natural sort, you will get A1, A2, and A11. So natural sort is a function that is implemented differently in different systems. There's all sorts of weird edge cases that can result in different behaviors, but I won't go into that in any detail now. As I say, this is a very short, high-level overview of the features. There's no time for a deep analysis in any of them. In fact, there's a few other talks that cover one or two of these features in detail, so you can stay tuned for that. But I think this example gives you a basic idea of what the idea behind natural sort is. The next one is compression. So compression has been quite a mess in the past in MariaDB, because to use a particular compression algorithm, it's had to be compiled into MariaDB. So that means compiling in lots of different algorithms. Which ones do you choose? There's all sorts of them. Do you go for as many as possible? Then, bearing in mind that most of them, if not all of them, are not going to be used by people, so now you're needlessly adding these into the server. And most people are only going to be using, if they are using any, just one or two. So there's always going to be some sort of waste of space there, basically. And another issue is that if you have a MariaDB server that's been compiled with a particular compression algorithm, you then move to another version of the server. Maybe it's the same version, but it just doesn't have that algorithm compiled in, you won't be able to access it. So it is a bit of a mess. And 10.7 brings quite a neat solution to the problem by allowing you to add these compression capabilities in through plugins. So it adds five compression plugins, VZIP2, LZMA, LZ4, LZO, and Snappy. And the default Zlib is, of course, always available. And then to use them, let's say you want to apply them to InnoDB compression. There's a system variable, InnoDB compression algorithm. You would normally set the global value to the particular algorithm, LZ4 in this case, and by default, it's not available. So you simply install the plugin, and now it is available to be used by your MariaDB compression. So it's a very neat, very elegant solution to the problem. One feature that's, I think, quite useful in certain contexts as well is MariaDB bulk inserts. And the idea is that only in empty tables, particularly empty tables, MariaDB will buffer and pre-sort the records for each index and then build the indexes based on that, one page at a time. So for empty tables in particular, bulk inserts are now quicker, quite substantially quicker. So that's a nice addition as well. Another one useful in a particular context only, many people won't find it useful, but for some users it's very critical, is password reuse. Now many environments have security policies that have particular checkboxes of features that need to be present in order to pass this policy. So a common one is not being able to reuse a particular password again. So MariaDB introduces a plugin in 10.7 to allow you to have this functionality. It prevents the new password from being the same as one that was previously used. And there's a period that passwords get saved for. This is configurable. By default, it's zero, which means indefinite. The system variable is password reuse check interval. And that allows you to specify in the number of days how long you want to keep the passwords for. Here's a basic example. You can install the plugin. Then when you specify a password, PWD1, everything's fine. When you want to reuse that password, PWD1 again, it fails and says your password does not satisfy the current policy requirements. And just to show you an example of the kind of hack people try to do when they are trying to be clever, if you now set it to PWD2 and then immediately back to PWD1, of course it doesn't accept that because it's been retained for that particular period of time. Still on 10.7, we've got a couple of additional JSON functions, one of them being JSON equals, which checks for equality between two JSON objects. So here's an example. You've got your key value A and B. In the one string, there's a whole lot of extra spaces. The order is different, A, B, and B, A. And the number is 3 versus 3.0. So you can see they are the same object. So once JSON equals is run, they are the same JSON object. So there is an equality there. So it returns the result of 1. The other function is JSON normalize, which is basically used by JSON equals to check for equality. And that's the one that recursively sorts the keys and removes the spaces and so on. So here's a possible use case. Maybe it's a bit of a stretch, but here we go. You can add a unique constraint using JSON normalize. So you have a unique key on a particular field and you add this constraint. Now when you insert a value and the keys in the key values in a particular order, you've got Alice and then blue. Now you insert again, but you insert blue Alice. This is functionally the same object, so normalizing it will make it identical, and then it will not allow you to insert that value again. It will give you a duplicate entry error. Then there are numerous optimizations as well that are being made in 10.7. Monty's talk coming up later today will cover numerous improvements in the optimizer in 10.7 in particular, so stay tuned for that as well. Now going on to 10.8, I think a key feature that could be very, very useful in a lot of environments is removal of the replication lag when running an alter table. So what has happened up until 10.7, up until to date, when an alter table is running on the primary, it has to first finish executing on the primary before it can start to be, before it gets replicated and before it can start to execute on the replica. So there's been a lot of performance improvements made with alter table, but of course it's unavoidable sometimes that alter tables can be quite heavy operations, and that could then result in quite substantial, quite noticeable replication lag. So this feature does away with that entirely. The replication and the beginning of the execution on the replica will begin immediately. So there is no replication lag there, which is great, I can see, in many contexts. Another 10.8 feature is to do with in-out and in-out parameters. Now, of course, stored procedures have had this since forever, but the enhancement in 10.8 allows stored functions to also support the parameter qualifiers, and cursors, of course, can support the in parameter qualifier. So that's a nice addition as well. One I'm quite happy to see some work on is the Spider storage engine. So Spider is a storage engine that basically allows you to do sharding. It allows you to access data on multiple different locations as if it was through as if it was on the local server and through one table. And there hasn't been too much development on it in the very recent past, so I'm quite happy to see that there's been lots of internal refactoring happening in 10.8. And one of the user-facing differences that has been made is that you can now declare Spider connections using these attributes, so the remote server, remote database, and remote table attributes, rather than before you had to basically abuse the comment field and stick them in there in order to declare these connections. So you would do it in this way: create your table, your various values, and then remote server, database table. Your remote server, of course, has been defined earlier, but it's a much more intuitive way of doing things and a much better way of doing things going forward. Another feature that's been quite heavily requested is adding GTID support to MariaDB binlog, or MySQL binlog, as the Simlink is known. So MariaDB binlog now supports filtering events by the GTID ranges and through the start position and the stop position options. And there's also an option, GTID strict mode, which permits validating a binary log's ordering of GTIDs. So that's been long requested, and very happy to see that as well. Windows users will be happy to see that 10.8 brings improved internationalization on newer versions in particular, more specifically, it's Windows 10, 1903 or later. The MariaDB client defaults to the UTF-8 MB4 character set. So that's the full UTF-8 character set. That's now the default, and several other problems with in the client with Unicode input and output were fixed as well. And all Unicode characters in usernames, database names, file names, etc. are now accepted in command line utilities. So that's a great addition. In the past, they were restricted to the current ANSI code page. So I think Windows users will particularly appreciate that. Then there's a couple of other features which are going to be covered in later talks today. There's improved histograms in 10.8. Sergey Petrunia is going to be covering that. That's the feature that first made an appearance in the preview release of 10.7. It didn't make it into 10.7, and it's now making a second appearance in 10.8, where hopefully it will stick around this time. And there's been numerous redo log improvements, numerous InnoDB redo log improvements that have a positive impact on performance. And Marco Makkala will be covering those in detail in a later talk as well. So thanks for watching. There's a couple of URLs there. As I say, this is a very, very quick overview of some of the new features. It hasn't gone into any detail at all. You can look more here at these two URLs, what's new in 10.7 and 10.8. That will give you a thorough list of all of the new features available. So please do go and have a look at them and let us know what you think. Thanks for watching.